We would like to warmly welcome you all to the Professional To Do workshop today. Actually, first of all, we are thankful to our eminent resource persons, Engineer Chandranan Fernando and Engineer Dhanapala, who came all the way from Colombo for the sole benefit of our members. So to start our work today, I would like to cordially invite Engineer Chandranan Fernando to start the presentation. Thank you.
The order of presentations, I'll be doing two presentations and followed by Engineer Dhanapala, maybe three or four, and then I'll come back for another two. Then this is going to be an interactive session. I want you all to participate. You have listened to me, some of you have listened to me before, so I'm a guy who will make you talk if you don't talk. So don't allow me to make you talk. I use various kinds of techniques, and I hope I will not be able to annoy you with those techniques. So please interact with me as much as you like. The whole purpose is, this is not a very formal student-teacher relationship. I'm talking to a set of experienced engineers. And you know as much as I know most of the things, and maybe you all are much more educated. I am in some of the things that you know. So I like and I want your feedback. So therefore, when I ask you to do something, you have to do it. Right? At that time, I am going to use school. You know, school teachers, how they cane people. So don't allow me to cane you if you don't obey me. And there are certain things I will ask you to do. You have to do it. No two words. Right? So that will come somewhere during the session. I'll not tell you when. So that kind of things I'll like you to respond very positively, because then it will stay in your minds what I'm trying to be, get across to you. You heard that I'm Chandranan Fernando, and I'm not going to take your time and ask you to introduce yourself. It's going to take a while. Why? But I still would like to know if there's anyone who doesn't understand Sinhala properly. Answer. All of you can understand Sinhala properly? You can't really understand, right? So, because I'm just asking you, my entire presentation will be in English. There's no two words about it. And I want to emphasize something for someone to get the whole thing into their head. Unfortunately, I can't talk in Tamil. If I could talk in Tamil, I couldn't talk in Tamil also. Right? I might emphasize certain things in Singapore. So please bear with me for one or two words. I'm sure you can understand. Right? Now, where are we? The presentation should be up. Somewhere there, I don't know. Yeah. Yeah, it's in this. So I will talk about the role of, who is an engineer, what is our role in the society, and I am going to discuss about the code of ethics. It's going to be a fairly long session and pretty boring. I must tell you, pretty boring. You will surely sleep, right? So what you should do, you can sleep. No problem. No problem, you can sleep. But you must do one thing. You must not allow the person next to you to sleep. Understand? Got it? You can sleep very well, you must know, there's no issue. But the adjoining person can't sleep. If I catch the other guy sleeping, I'll punish you. Either person left or right. If you are sleeping, I'll wake you up and say, come up, come on. You allow that fellow to sleep, so, right? You can sleep, but you can't have the other person to sleep. That's it. Okay, so I'm going to, this in from three segments, I'm going to define who's an engineer, I'm going to describe what is our role in the society, I will describe the code of ethics. Because that is the basis of the B paper. The basis of B paper. You have applied for B paper. Some of you may have done more than once. It doesn't matter. Even if you are successful, you can do it again. Because you will see at the end of the day, when I finish the introduction to B paper, what it's like, why we are being so very particular about B paper is after this, no more exams for you from the IELTS. So this time you want to make it very tough. Not that we are not very tough, we are making it tougher and tougher and tougher. So we want to raise the level of the engineers to a higher pitch. That is our goal. So therefore, over the years I have been associated with this project for the last at least 10-15 years. I have seen the B paper getting more and more refined. Right? Refined in the sense more and more attractive and more wide. And also the beauty is the large number of questions coming in, so you can pick and choose what you want to answer. Have you heard of this guy called Herbert Kraftwer? Hands up those who have heard the name Herbert Kraftwer. I have spoken about this more than 10 times in the IESN, so I am sure some of you have heard about this story. Is there anybody who has heard this? The story about the Herbert Kraftwer. If you have heard, please put your hands up. If you are not heard, please put your hands up. All of you have heard, not heard. No. Shaking your heads? No. Good. That makes my life easier, right, sir? Some of you will, my God. So fortunately, I am not going to say the same story again, because you are an instead of people. So there was a man named Herbert Kraftwer, and there have been two kinds of versions of the story. The latest version I read only yesterday. I'm sorry, I forgot to copy the set of words that are there. Beautiful words, right? It's a story of a man called Herbert Kraftwer. This guy, the early version says, was traveling a train. Now this version, the latest one, is straight from his diary. He was crossing the Atlantic in a luxury steam those days. Maybe late in the 19th century. Steam ships, right? He was in a first class cabin. And he used to, maybe they think about 2 months to cross the Atlantic those days. So he used to acquaint with a lady, who was a first class lady from England. And you know, these guys are, ladies are very prim and proper those days. They wear both skirts. So when you go about 1 meter, you know, people have to get away because the skirt will go and hit them. And same the behind, he'll sweep the ground for about 1 meter and go walk like this, skirts. So on the day that they were to leave, and they had breakfast, at the breakfast table, this lady had been talking to this guy for 2 months, but still, there was one question that went unanswered. I'm sure what the question to your mind, but I saw the question. That phrase I should have copied. She says, "Oh sir, please don't, not in my, these are my words, think that I am being very obtrusive or trying to get into your personal life. Please let me know what." No. "What is your profession?" Please tell me, what is your profession? The prime was thinking in her head. What if you didn't keep this in her head for 2 months? Right? And this guy said, "I'm an idiot." My God. The face of the lady fell. So was the skirt. Like this. And she shot back and said, "I thought you were a gentleman." Right? And with that, the conversation ended. They never saw each other after that. Finally, this guy was the only engineer who went on to become the president of the USA. And his name is Herbert Kraftwer. Most of the civil engineers will know about the Hoover Dam. He's named after him. And he said, I read, the Hoover Dam, it was first designed to take off the heat of the concrete. They estimated they need 100 years to cool it. That's the cooling of the dam. And they take 100 years, that's the time that they needed how to cool concrete. Okay? Maybe I'm wrong, maybe you can do some research, it's a Hoover Dam or something else. That they calculated and found that it takes 100 years to cool the concrete. So for those days, the engineers were smelly, wore overalls, had dirty hands, rough, tough, spoke often in filth. They never knew anything good words, right? Had very bad mannerisms. And therefore not recognized in the society. So it is at the time was not at all recognized in the society. But now, engineers are well recognized in society. Have clean hands. We have perfume. If you come close to me, you smell some kind of perfume. We have good mannerisms, I hope I do. And the society look up to them, the engineers. So this is the question I'm asking you. But do we live up to that? The multi-million dollar question. Do the engineers today live up to the expectations of society? Or do you want to go back to the era where thought we are not gentlemen? Okay, now let's get a little serious. The definition of the engineer taken straight from the Wikipedia, not my words. I added one word somewhere there. An engineer is a professional practitioner of engineering, stating the obvious. Engineer is a professional practitioner of engineering, concerned with applying scientific knowledge, underline the scientific knowledge, mathematics, and ingenuity. Or the keywords, scientific knowledge, mathematics, and ingenuity, to develop solutions for technical problems. Engineers design materials, do you? Actually, you do. Structures, you do design structures. Machines and systems. That's why we have system engineers. While considering the limitations imposed by practicality, safety, cost and I at the word environment. Practicality, safety, cost and environment. So those are within the bounds that you have to work. The word engineer is derived from the Latin root ingenium, meaning cleverness. Ingenium meaning cleverness is a Latin word. Now the first test. Come on guys, pat your own backs. Hi, Dhananda. Why? Okay, you all are clever guys. There are no one to pat your back except you. You all are clever guys. So, the very fact that you are an engineer tells you that you are a clever guy. Don't ever forget that. Don't ever behave like an unclever guy. Or a lady. Right? So, you are clever guys. To begin with, you are a clever guy. Otherwise, you can't be engineers. That's where we start. Going on, engineers are grounded in applied science and their work in research and development is distinct from the research focus of scientists. Right? If I ask someone to tell me the weight of this, an engineer, for a scientist, what is the weight of this? It is maybe 75.328688222 friends. For scientists. For engineer? What is the weight of this? For engineer? How much? You're not engineer, huh? 100 grams. 100 grams or 70 grams or whatever. So that is the difference. Science is exact science. Engineers are working as applied scientists. And it is distinct from the basic research of scientists. The work of engineers forms the link between scientific discoveries and applications to meet the needs of the society. There can be scientists maybe in the Iceland or Greenland or wherever, doing all kinds of scientific research and maybe publishing papers. It doesn't matter. For an engineer, you have to live in the society. You have to bring the scientific discoveries to meet the needs of society. Got it? I skipped one line, I'll come to that later. So this is the picture in which the engineering domain is intersected. What does it look like? What does it look like, that piece? Api kara kamathi na udaya. Tose kara de kiyam? Mona kani? Ekka tose kara de illa. Nathada? What is that? Like a pie or a Italy? Right? So that is the engineer. Italy is the engineer. And that's the intersection between scientific knowledge and societal needs. There's no point in having scientific knowledge in you if it doesn't meet the needs of society. You're an Italy or a pie. So what is in the pie makes all the difference. You can put tanakola or you can put vegetables, chicken or whatever that you like, and that makes a pie that you can eat. So we want you to be worthy people, worthy pies, not become pies, right? With tarapal inside. So the engineers are the intersection between scientific knowledge and societal needs. The central focus of the engineering profession is the application of scientific knowledge to meet the societal needs. Not only that, we are individuals. So we have our analytical skills and our creative skills. Some have more, some have less of each. Right? On the other hand, engineers may pursue creative efforts without involving analytical skills. And one may apply analytical skills without entering into the domain of creativity. Let's discuss how this is possible. That is you and me. Some of us are creative, some of us are not. Some are highly analytical, some of us are not. But still we are engineers. So therefore, it's the intersection of all four circles that matters. Okay, let me go a little bit further before I come to that topic. For example, as engineers apply commercial software to the solution of an engineering problem, the application of analytical skills per se may involve little or no creativity. You put in something, knowing your theory, without something, maybe there's very little creativity in that. It's highly analytical. You feel the strength is not good, you increase something, decrease something, increase concrete, increase rebars, whatever. Right? Same with the software architects. You don't get the speed that you want, you cut something here, you improve something there, so system is right. So no, not much of creativity there. On the other hand, an engineer may design an ergonomic office space with little analytical skills. When I gave it to the office, please, there's an ergonomic office space. How many of you know the word ergonomics? Please feel free to put your hands up if you don't know. That's the first thing. An intelligent man has to first admit that he doesn't know. So those, please put the hands up of those who do not know the word ergonomics. And any lecture in the son. Baranamsan. Very good. First of all, you must, because others run the risk. I ask him to come and explain. They will be completely humiliated. I am not going to do that. I have done that, but I am not going to do that. Right? So most of you don't know the word, meaning of the word ergonomics. Very good. I put it down here as ergonomics defined in the Oxford Dictionary. Designed for maximum comfort, efficiency, safety and ease of use, especially in the workplace. That's what you mean by ergonomics. Especially in the airplanes, ergonomics is a very common word. Right? You should be pleased to sit and relax and work. Right? Hence, let us now look at the engineering from all these post perspectives. So there you are. You still have the pie, you still have the Italy of engineering. Actually, there is something wrong in this picture. The segment 2 should not be dotted. It's the engineering domain that I am talking about. So all of us are engineers. So we must have the scientific and the societal needs as our prime objective. On the other hand, we do have our skills and strengths. We do have our creativity and skills and strengths. So now we have three categories of engineers called ABC. Who would like to be in the A category? Come on, put your hands up. I told you this is an interactive session. Who would like to be in the category A? Analytical engineers. If there are civil engineers for Dharmawala, chase all of them out. They don't know how to do analysis. So without analysis, most of the engineers in civil engineering at least cannot exist. Now, who are the analytical engineers? No one, only one. That was easy we can. Analytical engineers. Only two. Who are the creative engineers? 1, 2, 3, 4. Ah, good. Only two ladies. Anyway, good. Then ladies are creative. I don't know. Right? And who'd like to be the B category? A cannot talk with that. B category engineers. Good. Two. Good, great. So let's now see the definition of sector engineers. These represent the intersection of purely analytical talents within the engineering domain. This may be used to represent engineering science. And having to model complex systems. So these guys can model complex systems. Right? And predict their response to various inputs under various conditions. Isn't that what you do in a model? Company model? The segment of engineering has, of course, been the subject of intense development for the last half century and has benefited most directly from the availability of fast digital computers. So these guys can't exist now with those fast digital computers. Now those days I used to live this. We have an engineering heritage. Tuparame we have built and I have a structure. So they will say it's marvelous structure. Right? How did it happen? It happened maybe over a period of 40 years. But within now, with the tools that we have, maybe 4 seconds or 40 seconds or 4 minutes, you can get the answer. Is that so? Not so. Now that is the difference. So over the years, our analytical skills have grown to such an extent using all the modern marvels to get an engine design done relatively short time. That's the only difference. Right? Sector C, the intersection of creative capacity with the engine domain can be viewed as representing those sudden intuitive leaps, often responsible for revolutionary advances in technology called significant novelty. I should have brought some pictures. I want to bring some pictures. I didn't have time to do that. Once I went to Japan, and in Japan, in Tokyo, there is a river. And in that river, it's called the River of Museum of Bridges. I don't know how many of you have been to this beautiful river. Right? There are about 40 different structures of bridges along the river. Each bridge different to the other. So these are created by the Sector C engineers who have created in their genes. So we said that you are creative engineers. Good. You would like to see boxes, concrete. In our cities, now in Colombo, it's all now nice new designs. If you go to places like Dubai or something, my God, marvels of building design that you have. Singapore, same. I'm sure most of you have traveled overseas, right? So, creative engineers we need Otherwise, this world becomes very monotonous and very dull. So we need the Hindus, right? As well as those aspects of India that are not yet fully supported by Indian science, that remain more an art than a science. I think we have also in our working groups, you know, sometimes when we have difficult problems to solve, how to hide this column, how to hide this apartment or this or the other. Someone in your group will come and say, my God, sir, shall we do this thing? Those are the intuitive clarity that's coming out of your engineers. And of course, B, the intersection of knowledge and need with both creative and analytical capability can be used to represent engineering design and much real world problem solving. But that doesn't mean they are the superior, right? We need all three categories of engineers. I just said that. This sector includes activities ranging from developing innovative products and processes to creating an innovative bridge design to develop a new control process for petroleum industry and so on and so forth. So we need to require all these kinds of engineers amongst us. Not anyone is superior. They all have the same, if you measure perhaps the same area in that point. So I said, taking from one of the earlier slides, engineers are creative problem solvers. How? In the evening, you want to have a beer. You don't have a glass. What do you do? I would recommend this. So this is what you mean by creative problem solvers. You solve the problem in a very creative way. Right? Do you want engineers of this kind? Not just to drink beer or to cut glasses, but to make things that are feasible out of near infeasibility. What about the other sectors in the above figure? Say, let's take sector 1, which is the intersection of analytical skills with societal needs outside the bounds of scientific knowledge. I don't quite agree with this word economics that I just take from literature. This might include economics, because there are economics factors that you know you require on behavioral sciences, behavior of people. And philosophy, most certainly, you can draw analysis, but not maybe outside the scientific boundary. But it needs the certain need of the society. Without philosophers, there is no Lord Buddha. Right? So Lord Buddha, imagine the society that we are living in. So we need philosophers, even of economists. Sector 3, which is pure creativity, once again meeting the needs of society, maybe artists. Sector 2 may be used to represent those societal needs outside the bounds of scientific knowledge that require both analytical skills and creative skills, perhaps including public policy. Business administration. You go to anyone on the street who is running a good business. You may not know you are E equals MC squared or any other Dabas and Dells and differential equations, but it sure knows how to run the business. Right? In a creative way. And music. Music requires scientific knowledge. Right? Not really scientific, but you know, analytical skills to combine the notes. So engineers cannot ignore the above very real issues in the society. They were bounded by those needs of society. Now I'm getting a little bit more serious as we go on. Now I have taken this from the international literature called the Accreditation Board for Engineering and Technology. It's called ABET, of the USA. Huge organization, maybe the single most huge engineering organization in the whole world. I mean, right? Obviously, identifies engineering, and once again, this is interpretation of engineering. We are still on the subject of engineering, defining engineering. That profession in which knowledge of mathematical and natural sciences gained by study, keep the study in mind, I'm going to come back to that. Experience, he's going to talk of experience, and practice is applied with judgment, you require creativity to develop ways to utilize economically the materials and forces of nature. That's what you're doing. You're using materials and forces of nature. Right? Material science, mechanics of matter. Right? Mechanics of motion, force of nature, for the benefit of mankind. So mankind is there always. We can't get to the mankind. Can we? Getting more and more complicated. What does the International Protein Engineers Agreement say? Now, International Protein Agreement is the one that in which ISL is a part of it. Among 70 known countries in the whole world, including countries like USA, UK, Britain, Scotland, USA, England, Ireland, South Africa, Australia, New Zealand, Hong Kong, Malaysia, Taiwan, Singapore, Turkey, Russia, right? And countries like Japan, Korea, Hong Kong, and we have 16 countries, Sri Lanka, ISL, and the 17 countries, India. And I think I have just one more country last year. So we are among 17 or 18 countries in the whole world who comply with these regulations, with these norms of engineering. And there are three categories here, called the Washington Accord graduates, Sydney Accord graduates, and Dublin Accord graduates. These are all engineering shades of engineering. We'll talk about this later on as we go on, maybe in the evening. Now, I'll consider the Washington Accord graduates. Now, it doesn't mean that you all got to be Washington Accord graduates. Washington Accord graduates can only be produced in Sri Lanka only after the 14th of June 2014. But you fall into the category of that attributes that are there. Okay? I'm not going to deal up all these arguments. So please go to the website and study about these things. Washington Accord is for full-fledged engineering graduate degrees. Sydney Accord is for what we call 3-year or engineering technologies. And the Dublin Accord is for 2-year diplomatic level people, or even little lower technicians. Right? So all three are given there. I'll consider only on the Washington Accord. They apply knowledge of mathematics, science, engineering fundamentals, and engineering application, specialization, as specified in WK1 to 4 is the knowledge attributes, respectively, to the solution of complex engineering problems. I'll touch upon this in the later in the day. We are going to touch upon complex engineering problems. And you have the threshold of becoming a professional engineer, which means, given a complex problem, you are able to solve it. Even if you are not able to solve it by yourself, with a group of like-minded engineers. Right? And in short, the range qualifier in several attribute statements used the notion of complex engineering problem. Broad and for the 3-year degree guys, broadly defined engineering problem. The problem is defined. For us, the problem is not defined. And for technologists, technicians, well-defined engineering problem. We know that. Our technicians, they just go and tighten the screws, put the grease, put some water here and there. Right? They are working in a domain of well-defined engineering problems. Our middle-level guys are working on broadly defined engineering problems. And we guys, engineers, are going to tackle not defined, complex engineering problems. That is how we are categorized. Please keep that in mind. I'm going to come to that later. I'm going to go through this. Please look at this once you go home. I think these are going to be in the web. Right? Concentrate on the W, that is Washington Accord. Once again, I'll take one or two. Depth of knowledge. I said, scientific knowledge is important. Cannot be resolved without in-depth engineering knowledge. That is why you require a good degree behind you. At the level of one or more jargon, which loves fundamentals, base, first principles, analytical approach. Now this is what I really find difficult to understand. We engineers, I'm not throwing at you, we engineers have gone through at least 40 battles of engineers in my life, or maybe even more. Over the years we have found, we have forgotten our fundamentals. We have forgotten our first principles. When I get a problem, I still start from the first principles. Right? When you put, drop something, I'm not going to drop this, at this height, it can fly. It doesn't fall back to the ground. Some of us engineers sometimes believe that when you drop this, it should fly. Believe me, I'm telling this after 36 years of public service in this country. So, you guys, I'm emphasizing on this fact. You can't have a solution that doesn't address the fundamentals. You can't have a solution that doesn't have the basic principles. That is not engineering. One day at a seminar in Peradeniya, I was with the Upper Kotkale. I went and addressed a group of about 500 to 600 students. This was organized by the Department of the University of Peradeniya. And during the question time, one guy got up and said, "I don't believe a word of what you said." I asked why. "I live there in Kotkale. There's no water in the Kotkala way." I said, "Why?" "No, you are in Colombo, you don't know. I'm living in Kotkale. I've been living my whole life, I'm living in Kotkale. And there's no water in Kotkale." So I didn't want to get into an argument. I asked him, "From which faculty are you?" I thought he'd be from the geography faculty or something. He said, "Faculty of Engineering." I got shocked. What is the field, right? He said, "Civil engineering." I said, "Okay, fine. No problem, Buddha. Maybe you are right. Let's meet after this seminar. I'd like to have a word with you. I want to find out from you why you come to this conclusion." So after the seminar, but five fellows came, "Why do you say there's no water in the Kotkala Valley?" "I know, sir. I live there." I said, "Do you know that we have come to this conclusion after analyzing 50 years of hydrological data? Maybe when you see, there's no water. I agree with you. But when you take the data and analyze, you find there's water." So most of us engineers sometimes jump into conclusion without going on to the fundamentals. Right? We talk of, I have heard enough people talk of climate change now. Climate change is a phenomenon that is taking place over years. All what you see now with the sudden rain, sudden flooding, sudden this, that and that, those are maybe certain precursors of the climate change. But that's not climate change actually. There are certain aberrations of what we call now in the jargon they say, extreme weather events. Right? So there are extreme weather events. I also agree that I was told in 2014 we had every 4 days rain. A 4 days rain in a week, so 3 days have been dry on the average. Maybe there's something wrong, something different now happening. But this may be a matter related to climate change. But you can't call this climate change that has happened now. It's happening, all right. So don't draw conclusions based on what you see, and also seeing and observing is the most important thing in scientific discoveries. But then you go to the root and find out why. So that is the depth of knowledge that we require from you engineers. I will not go into detail. Please take time and look at this chart very carefully, concentrate on the first column, and that is what you should be when you become a fully professional engineer. That's what we and the IIT and the whole world expect on you to become. Now let's talk about the, I talked about the scientific knowledge, let's talk about the responsible society. Engineers' inherent interaction with society and societal needs leads naturally to an engineer's responsibility to society. You interact with society and you are responsible to society, therefore, which include safety and welfare of the public and the clients and of clients. Safety and welfare of the public and of the clients. Also welfare of client. Right? Even your employee. Professional ethics. I'm going to dwell on this a little bit more. Later on. You should be aware of the legal liabilities of whatever you do. You should be aware of the liability. How many RD meetings are here? I'm just, don't get me wrong. Maybe you take this back home and discuss with your seniors. I came on the highway. Right? Those days when there's obstruction, kilometers ahead, there's a warning signal. Given. There's a deviation, this, that, and the other. Of course, between Gaul and Madhara, there's a severe deviation. And that is given 7 kilometers ahead. Very good. But on this normal maintenance work where people are there cutting grass and so on and so forth, and there were stretch where there were cones placed without any warning anywhere right in the middle of the road today. That's not good. That's not adhering to safety of the public. Fortunately, I had a good vision. I'm still 60, I still have still a good vision. What about the guys who can't see far? Right? So please, don't get me wrong. Don't go and tell your superior. Okay, they can't have the plan, sir. You can never have anything and nothing thing. Right? I think our engineers should tell the highways that there's a department, I think, to give sufficient warning to the portraits to deviate if there's even a small maintenance activity. Those days they're not there. Predominantly, I have been on this road several times and in the Patnaik road. But I think sometimes we start ignoring these things. Right? So that's the legal liability of engineers. Suppose something happens. Maybe the engineer gets fired. Or there's a lawsuit. You should be aware of the legal liabilities. Environmental responsibility. You can't vandalize environment. Quality is your prime responsibility, and the way you communicate. The way you communicate with everybody, right, is your responsibility. Engineers' approach to problem solving. It is just as important that engineers' first approach, ethical, safety, liability, environmental, quality, and communications issues. You may be a bright engineer. If you can't communicate what you have found out to a superior or a subordinate or the public or anybody, client, no use. Establish that communication channel first. Ethical standards, you cannot compromise, that's first. Safety, you cannot compromise, that's first. You have no license to kill anybody. I go on telling this to everybody. You are not licensed to kill anybody. Environmental is a common good. You can't vandalize the environment. Quality is your prime responsibility. You resolve these issues first, in the first step of the problem solving. Find out, the moment you have a problem, is this ethical? Am I going to do my work in a safe manner? What is the liability that I have? What are the economic resources that I am going to use, not vandalize? Quality. How am I going to ensure quality? How am I going to communicate my findings, or my instructions, or the instructions that I receive? How am I going to receive that? Communications is a fundamental. Right? You will have to come in front if you have no option because you came late. You will come in front. That's all right. When I go give lectures in Colombo, I close the door, not close, I keep a guy at the door at 5:05. And I keep the first 2-3 doors empty. And all of them who come after 5:05, have a competence for students. And if you have no option, but you have a competence for students. Good. So we have Delhi University in the back course. How many? 3 lakh. This allows engineers to address and analyze each element of the problem from the problem statement to the release of the product or service to the customer. Right through the problem solving process, you are going to be conscious about the ethical standards, safety standards, your liabilities, environmental resource that you are going to use, ensuring the quality, and how you communicate everything. This is fundamental. 6 things you've got to be in your system, running in your veins. Without blood, you can't live. Without these 6, you can't do an engineering design. Okay? This idea is to address the analyze each element of the problem from the problem statement to the release of the product or services to the customer. This allows engineers to integrate the consideration of ethical and other concerns directly into the thinking process. So if as much as blood runs in your veins and that helps to think, these 6 elements should run in your veins to start solving a problem of engineering. So then you don't get a miss. Other concerns related to the thinking process and to expand the alternative designs. In another type, talk of alternative designs. In engineering, there's nothing called the only design. Nonsense. You start off by saying thinkers, clever guys, ingenuity, cleverness. So you have to come out with alternative designs where you may have to compromise certain things to potentially eliminate or reduce the problem that I said about, rather than simply to react to the problems later on. As in engineers, who I term them as monkeys on hot bricks. Have you seen monkeys on hot bricks? Haven't you seen engineers running around like that? Oh my god, you can't. You know, act like a cool as a cucumber, they say. Right? And if you have taken all these considerations while you are doing the design, nothing will go wrong. I still remember what you buy. Sorry, may I be RDA by Gandhi? Very sorry, yeah, because RDA can be seen everywhere. He was working with RDA, those days it was called the Highways Department, so not anyone that you know. He's not in here, he's in Australia. Right? They got a new mixture for pre-mix cycle. Putting more of this and more of that and this and that. So they did the experiments in the laboratory, it worked perfectly. Somehow the texture of one of those additives went wrong, and when they were about to lay the premix, they laid the premix, right? I heard top will lay in the lab, car skip kernel. So what did he do to us? He took the vehicle, got lost. Those days for him there were no cell phones, and hit somewhere before his boss started coming and asking questions. Is what you call monkey on hot bricks. I'm not blaming him. He's my very good friend, right from the campus days. I'm not demeaning him. He was a young engineer, right? Most of this would have happened to us, even to me. I would act like monkey on hot bricks at one time or another. They will learn. And fortunately, there are guys like us who have made mistakes and not taking it, talking to you. So concentrate on these responsibilities that you have towards society before those become problems to you. Right? So widen your horizon, widen your thinking pattern. Thinking process and expand the already designed to potentially eliminate the reduce or reduce problems rather simply to react to the problems later on. Okay, still on the subject of engineering. Royal College Academy of Engineering, it's UK, and the Engineering Council, most of you are aware of Engineering Council, have identified 4 fundamental principles that they believe should guide an engineer in achieving the high ideals of professional life. Very simple. And which express the beliefs and values of the noble project that you and I are. I think I'm going to do another exercise. You have to respond now. I'm sorry, I'm going to shout. I know that you are going to respond. Until you respond, all of you, I'm going to shout. And if you have taken part in the exercise before, don't take part. But still, you have to take part in the exercise. Right? I'm sure some of you have taken part with me before. Are you all engineers? Put your hands up. Those who are engineers, put your hands up. Marketing engineers, all marketing engineers. No, full engineers, full engineers. Full engineers. Higher, you can raise the hand higher. Higher. Think out of the box, you can go higher. Only three engineers or four engineers can think out of the box. The problem with us engineers. We want to be in the comfort zone of the seat and solve the problem. You can't. You can't raise the higher than that. You sit in your comfort zone. Basically, this is a nice chair. They have a room. So if you guys who are engineers want to be counted, I counted them. You have to think out of the box. You have to stretch your limits. You have to get out of the comfort zone. In all languages, out of the comfort zone. When the comfort zone, you start sitting in the airplane, you know, working in the computer, that should be alright. Stretch your limits. Go to the field and find out what's happening. That is getting out of the comfort zone. Don't always think of the path of least resistance. You are used to getting to the path of least resistance. Well, I'm an engineer, so when you fix a voltage, the highest current flows in the path of the least resistance. All the engineers go in the path of the least resistance, but you be the exception. You get out of the path of the least resistance and get out of the comfort zone. We want engineers of that kind. And you'll be counted. So what are these four areas? Accuracy and rigor. There's no cutting short to accuracy and rigor. Rigor means you continue to check the design, understand all kinds of problems. Right? Rigor, accuracy and rigor. Honesty and integrity. How do I put that first? Honesty and integrity. There's no space for engineers to be dishonest or without integrity. Respect of life. I said you can't kill people. Law and the public good. What is public good? We seldom respect the public good. The moment I force it down, these people don't do that. You eat a coffee and put the coffee wrapper on the pavement, you are expending the public good. That payment is for public, not for your own use. Right? Respect the public good. You go to a park, right? Vandalize. You can't. It's a public good. So public good has a very wide definition. I have no time to go through all that. But study these things. Responsible leadership. Now you are going to be professional engineers. You have to have your leadership. People should be able to look up to you and say, he's my leader. Not my manager. Not my boss. He's a true leader. Sometimes maybe your peer is your leader. But he tells you, I have to go for lunch. Sir, I will have a kanyan. I know of an engineer whose leader is the driver. Drive like that, sir. Five it out. Handle it. How is it? Drive. Sir. Baba, what are you doing? Baba, you should do it. Handle it. Who is the leader? Drive is the leader. Right? lead from the front? Hands up, hands up. Who like to lead from the front? Who wants to be led from behind? Hands up. Led from behind. Follow your low one. Do you know the people who are led from behind are the set of buffaloes? If there are passing any, I'm sure you don't like to be in there. You led from behind. You want to leave. Okay, good. All of you said that you want to leave. We'll come there later. Now I just a little bit on the ISL because I am going to talk about the code of ethics, the last part of the lecture. Right? What is ISL? A professional engineering body, incorporated act of parliament. Why ISL? That is one group of new entrants to CEB. I went and had a lecture. The first thing I asked is, how many of you ISL? Fortunately, there are about group of about 58. 56 people said they know what ISL. Two people in one did not know what ISL is all about. Out of the 56 people, I asked, how many of you know where it is? But 30 people said, we know where it is. I'm not going to ask that question from you. I know that you know about ISL. And also, you know where ISL is recorded. Maybe 99% of you have listened to ISL at one time or another. Right? It's a very powerful act of parliament. As a professional body, ISL has to act in the best interest of the engineering profession, members, and public. Our vision, to be amongst the leading professional institutions at the center of excellence and leadership in the fields of engineering and technology in Asia. And we can be, very soon we can be. For the sustainable, this is a vision, a long-term vision. For the sustainable and efficient management of resources to improve the quality of the life of people. All of you know, I think, we are the oldest professional body of engineers in the whole of Asia. And very few among the world. How many of you knew that? We are 110 years old. There is a single institute that can boast of in Asia this length of history. But fortunately, this our professional institution is not the issue of the oldest profession. You don't understand physical regulation. There is an oldest professional institution, but fortunately not an institution of the oldest profession. Our mission to make the institution the focal point from all practicing, for all practicing professional potential engineers of all disciplines to develop and harness the talents and professional values to achieve engineering excellence and leadership in society through capability building, setting and maintaining standards to proactively influence the national policy making for sustainable and efficient management of the resource. So it's a very responsible organization. I'm taking all this time to tell you about the ISL because the next set of slides I'm going to develop on the Code of Ethics. And this is the institution in which you are aspiring to be full members. So it's not a took to the gay organization. It's not a took to the gay organization. We have very high ideals. So our ideals will be achieved only if you achieve this. That has taken so much of time, almost an hour or a little bit more. 1 hour, 40 minutes, I think. We started 2 o'clock. No. Still we are there. 1 hour, 3 minutes. Perhaps. To impress on you the value of engineering. All this is required for you to address the problems you may encounter in your attempt to become a professional engineer. Maybe during the Viva, maybe while answering the A paper, or while answering the B paper. I took so much of time just to impress on you the value of engineering, as written in the mission and vision statement. Long history, blah, blah, blah. We have international recognition. We are a full secretary of the International Professional Engineers Agreement. If you become international professional engineer of the ISL, you can practice in any of those 16 countries without having to pass any other qualifying exams, but of course you have to get the license to practice in those countries. Full secret of the ocean record, which means from 2014 January, those who get accredited by the ISL, the general degrees, their degree will be in par with the international agreements, standards, and ocean record universities. Such a valuable thing. I said that over the launch, you know, Rona is very well on the way in complying with the requirements of the ocean record. Not that other two universities are not, they are also there, but Rona is doing exceptionally well. I hope I won't be comforted by the world where the delivery guys. The operating framework, I don't want to take too time. What do we do based on the objects set out in the Act? Enrolled members and ensure the process that titles are granted to them based on their competencies. So this is your hurdle. You have to check your competencies. And that I will talk about perhaps in the writing of the report. The competencies we are going to check. If it's not there, please look up in the website. The five competencies are clearly written. Right? You have to check on your competencies. Promote study of engineering. Establish and maintain standards for engineering education by acting as an accredited body. Establish and maintain standards for professional practice of engineering. Professional practice of engineering. We set standards. We provide CPD. I'm sure you are doing a lot of work in the rule chapter. I congratulate that. Maintain standards of professional ethics and conduct. As much as you drive on the road, you have to obey the rules of the highway code, and the police will catch you. And if you are practicing as an engineer, you have to conform to the standards set by the engineers. These are engineers, ISL. So I will not go into detail. Now, next half an hour or so, for 45 minutes, I am going to get into the most boring part of the lecture. As I said before, you can sleep, you can't allow the next person to sleep. Okay? So this is going to be the most important, but the most boring part of the lecture. I don't have jokes anymore. I run out of jokes. Maybe I'll try to dig something out. Okay? To keep you awake. Because there will be two questions on, there will be one question on code of ethics. There will be a choice of two. I'll talk about that later. And it's compulsory. And I've seen some of the answers. They are horrible. Most of them are horrible. So I want you to absorb in the late afternoon, early afternoon, after a full stomach, almost time to sleep. Keep away or keep the neighbor away and listen to this very carefully. It's the most important part of it. Code of ethics. Engineering ethics is a deterrent to bad practice and an inspiration to innovation and creativity. I must admit, it springs out of these four principles that I discussed from the Council of Engineering, right? And stemming from that, then later on after I discuss the Code of Ethics of ISL, I'll go back to the those NJ Council goals and check what I have. But I must admit, I have also told this in the Council, our Code of Ethics is far too complicated for a normal engineer to read and understand. So I have presented them in single and tamil. I have made it into a pocket calendar size thing where you must every day, like the Bansil Padamaha, read that and try to get that into your head. No other way. The one time anybody can put a petition and we'll be judging you on the, against the Code of Ethics. And you can be punished. Right? The more and we educate the public, the more and more you become vulnerable to these problems. So Code of Ethics is very important. It's a Bible. As a deterrent to bad practice as well as an inspiration to innovation and creativity. So please pardon me if I become boring. right? And if you want to make it interesting, you can ask questions. There are 8 clauses. And each clause, there are about 5 or 6 rules. The rules that you have to worry and clause you have to keep in mind. And I'd like you to study this definitely before you go for the BBA. It's very important that you understand the whole thing. Otherwise, you look, you write numbers. I must tell you. Clause 1. Engineers shall hold paramount the health, safety, and welfare of the public and proper utilization of funds and other resources in the performance of their professional duties. It shall take precedence over their responsibility to the profession. You might think I am doing nonsense. Sectoral or private interests. Even employers will go against if they are telling someone to do something unethical. And other things. Easily said, but very difficult to do. But you are doing. If not, somebody can complain about you, we can hold an inquiry, we can punish you. Rules. I'll go very fast. And the first requirement places the interest of the community above all others. Engineers, therefore, shall be objective and truthful in writing professional reports, issuing statements, or submitting testimony. They shall include all relevant and pertinent information in such reports, statements, or testimony. You can't hide anything that you know. They will be truthful. Rule number 2. Shall endeavor at all times to maintain engineering service essential to the public welfare. Don't hit any part. Okay, I am thinking of something else. Okay. Electrical. If you have to do some maintenance in a certain section, we take off the lights. But then you are depriving the people in that area of the electricity. So we now in the CB try to minimize this by having very fair feeding arrangements. As you develop, you always have alternate feeding arrangements. To a large segment of the public, we can still maintain services by raising the feeding arrangements. Right? Maybe same with the roads, same with the water, same with the telecom in every sector. We have no right to deprive the people of the service that we are giving them. Of course we have to deprive certain rights, but we are minimized. Shall work in conformity to recognized engineering standards so as not to jeopardize the health, safety and welfare of the public. Conform to the design standards, conform to the codes that you know. Don't go against that. The other engineer in my organization was always trying to, he thought he was the best thing. So all what he said was, the moment we have standards, he used to defy the standards and prove that he is right. Sometimes he is right, but most often he is wrong. Still he is doing. Right? So, standards are there. If you want to revise them, do it in a methodical manner, otherwise conformity. Shall not participate in assignments that would create conflict of interest between their clients, employers, and the public shall advise the client of their concerns. You can't act what you call conflict of interest. You can't be the engineer and also be the contractor. Most of the engineers do that. They have construction now under their wife's name or the nephew's name or the niece's name or the mother-in-law's name, father-in-law's name, and do the same contracts that you are supervising. Maybe you are knack to do business and engineering. Do something else. Do for some other client, maybe overseas. Well, find some job, say it. I am not saying don't. Further your knowledge and skills, it's okay, but don't act with conflict of interest. The problem you do that, you start small. How much? 40%? මම උදව්වක් කරන්නේ මේ 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 SMB මගාර ගිහද කියලා කියන්න තුන දුන්නා නේද සල්ලි ගත්තද පොට්ට 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 මඩංගරන් මහා පරිමාණයේ බිස්නස් කාර්ය වෙන්නේ අපිට බිස්නස් කාර්ය වෙන්නේ කියලා You can't do it with conflict of interest. I know an engineer CV who is, I do not talk too much about it, who is a big businessman. That's all right. Being a big businessman. But you can't do business while doing office hours. You can't compromise office hours. Right? I'll stop at that on that. So, shall in the event of the Duncan being overruled, in matters pertaining to health, safety and welfare of the community, inform their clients or employers of the possible consequences of bring to the clients or the employers notice. That is, okay, you give a decide and your boss or the employer or the part who may work in this case, not make out of that. Then try to record my heart of the network. You're compromising on the health of the workers. Right? මෙතන රෙඩි කතාවට එපා ඔය ගාන වැඩි. නිරුතන ගානට හරි ගන්න ඔය බ්‍රිජ් එක දිගේ යන්න. You are compromising the safety of the workers or the safety of the pedestrians or whatever. If somebody is overruling you, immediately you have to tell them, sir, that's all right, but you take the responsibility for the life of the, this man, if he dies. Right, sometimes you may have to, you may be overruled, But they have to immediately tell the consequences of the overruling. Shall contribute to public discussion on engineering matters and their areas of competence. Officer may Dodanogi in the man. If he knows that something is going wrong, he's obligated to point it out. Shall get involved in public debates. Of course, with the permission of your bosses. You just can't, because you are a big guy here, when say, give statements to the press and the TV, next day you get a letter of explanation. Right? But it's your duty to get involved in public debates. If they consider that by doing so they can constructively advance the well-being of the community. Having knowledge of any alleged violation of the code of ethics, code of by others, shall cooperate with the proper authorities in furnishing such information or assistance as may be required. Prasanga Ani. Machanta India is a macho. මම කොට කියන්නේ නැහැ. හැබැයි මේ දිගර මේ කරන් ගියොත් තම පුතෝ මට කාටද කියන්නේ. You must have the guts. You must have the guts. That is what you mean by integrity. If you are not already, you become one. I recruited a lot of people and after a certain question, everybody whom I recruit, mostly the young, caste and all, the first thing I tell them is, Ora Oti Dande. After some time, when CC came and said, Samara Vedi. Quite. Look at the EPF numbers. These guys, 100 hours, 80 hours, 70 hours, 60 hours. These guys, 20 hours, 30 hours, 40 hours. So, Balan, there are the elders. If you constantly tell your subordinates, don't do something wrong, they will not do it. If you ignore that, they will continue to do that something wrong. So same with your colleagues. Recently I met a middle-level lecturer guy who challenged his boss and he was just about to be dismissed. He came to me with the letter and told me the whole story. I told him the wrong he has done. Finally he started crying. I said, Sir, Mao Gidra Yamuti, Maga Mali Nagi Dina Ma Yoga Kanto, Maga Dhamai Dushan Dhamai Dhamai Dhamai. Samao Kumar Hiya. He was in my office for about 4 hours. I wasted my time. It doesn't matter. I made him a man. Still he is working. Finally he cried and cried and cried. I said, Sir, me varadda matakirte na khabu dhiri ne. කිසි කෙනෙක් මට කියලා දුන්නේ නැහැ මම ගන්න වැඩි දෙයක් කියලා. So don't assume things. Don't assume others know what they should be doing. No. If they don't know, it's your duty to tell them that you're wrong. Right? shall not knowingly pass in net which will result in waste or misappropriation of public funds. You have no right to waste public funds. Shall actively contribute to the well-being of society and will involve in any engineering project or application of technology, shall and where appropriate recognize the need to identify, inform and consult affected parties to help resolve problems. So if something would happen to a certain family, if not correct to wait to the last one, just because now we have got the eviction order, please get out. You got to prepare them well ahead. Loku unnai amme methinga parakkanawa methara me podi elak elak kanawa ogule giyawata aith karanna wenawa api saakatcha kala wenna hodala karamu. Why can't you do that? Spend little time. How much time we waste chatting and gossiping and loitering? Spend some of your time to do educate. Clause number 2. Engineers shall always act in, I'll take those 10 minutes and stop because at 3:50 I'll stop and they have this presentation and 3:30 we go for tea. Engineers shall always act in such a manner as to uphold and enhance the honor, integrity and dignity of the profession by safeguarding public interest at all times. Public is always there. You can't get rid of the public. The yogi was right. This requires that the engineering profession should endeavor by behavior to merit the highest esteem of the country. I start off by saying about you, we thought you are a gentleman. I said we want you to be gentlemen. So people hold us in high esteem. So behave like that. We want you all to be put in high pedestal, say this is an engineer. So hold them in high esteem. You don't want to lose your stand. Shall not involve themselves with any business or professional practice which they know to be fraudulent or dishonest in nature. You can't get involved in fraudulent activities at all. Shall not associate with persons, corporations or partnerships to conceal unethical acts. Shall not contribute in partnership with or act in professional matters with any engineer who has been removed from membership of the institution because of improbity. I'll tell you a small story about a young engineer. I was involved in the renewable energy field for a long time in this country, and there was a guy who wanted to get involved too. Renewable projects. I spoke to a guy who was well known in the country at that time, who was reputed to be a good solar power engineer. Right? I spoke to him and he immediately took this boy because I recommended him. After some time, he came utterly desperate to my room and said, "Sir, I can't do this well." I said, "Why? Do you know why? This fellow is not an engineer." He told me that he is from Perth, because he knew that I was from Kathmandu. He said he is from Perth. He told that he has attended the same school that I attended, but when I asked some names, he couldn't quite recall, but I accepted because he was about 5 years junior to me. Then he had in his card MIESL. MIEE at that time, Member of the Institute of Engineers and Member of the Institute of Sri Lanka, in his car, and BSc honors in engineering. So this guy, young fellow, maybe about maximum 8 years, I would say, maybe 2 years into the job, went to Bharatanatyam, checked all the registers, his name was not found. Went to my old school, checked all the registers in his age, found he has never been to school. Came to me, asking me to find out whether he is a member of the IESL and IEEE. I checked up the IESL register, he is not a member of the IESL. I checked up the IEEE register, he is not a member of the IEEE. So I told him and I gave him letters. Armed with these letters and armed with all this information, he went and met the managing director of the company. 28-year-old guy, huge conglomerate in this country, managing director, Mr. Yamil, you can see. I said, sir, I can't work in this company. Not only that, he didn't stop at that. These are the letters. So and so is not an engineer. Though in his card it says he is a chief engineer at that time. He is BSc engineering? No. He is MISF? He is a writer? No. MIEE? No. What do you think the management is? Good puta, you are all right, you know. I'll give you a promotion. You know what he said? Sorry. I don't care whether he's an engineer or not. He's doing my work. I still have those two cars with me. Next time when he came to see me, he was promoted as a director engineer from chief engineer. So this is the society in which we are living. For fraudulent practices, you get promotions. There are so many other stories, I will not tell you more about that person. He married a niece of a friend of mine, posing as an engineer. Now they have huge problems in the marriage. Right. So don't ever try to do that kind of thing. Clause number 3. Engineers shall build their reputation on merit and shall not compete unfairly. This requirement is to ensure that engineers shall not seek to gain benefits by improper means. Shall neither pay nor offer directly or indirectly to induce funds to others. Shall promote the principle of engineering engagement of engineers upon the basis of merit. They shall uphold the principles of adequate and appropriate remuneration for professional engineering staff in keeping with their qualifications and market price. You can't hire an engineer and pay them peanuts. To pay the peanuts, you get monkeys. We know that you can't do that in this country. Salaries are fixed, I know that. But you have to do at least what we can do to uphold his integrity and the esteem as an engineer. That's what we can do. So slowly but surely in this country, the engineering salaries are going up. Thanks to the organizer that I work, Sirawal Exit Board, we gave them the first target. We deviated from the rest of the staff and we got a service scale for the engineers. Not because of me, collectively engineers. So we are having good salaries now. Good revenue, don't drop. I'm sure most of us have very good salaries. Right? But it has to be empowering our experience and knowledge. Shall not attempt to supplant another engineer employed or consulting who has been appointed without his consent. This happened once again in a project I was working in. Not I was working, I had some hand. We appointed a person called senior project, called project director. Our particular project. After getting applications and appointment. Of course, once that project was formed and the project was appointed, that project was of course went out of my control to another branch. After some time, somebody thought that we need another person. Even without the knowledge of this person, they appointed a person for senior project director. I put him on it. He got fed up and left. If you think that you have to replace him, most certainly replace him. But in the knowledge with him, after discussing with him, I had done that. The same project later on, there was a guy who could not perform. And we were up against a very, very difficult project. I called him and said, you come and work for me. I'll give you all the benefits. You do the same work, but a different way. We have to put another project director in this project. He did that. And he found that he could not cope up with the work due to a certain disability that he had. He had a stroke. And if that stroke, that unfortunate medical condition, if I just put a person above him, he would have died. Then and there. But I got him honorably removed from that place and put another person. That's all right. But don't do it without his knowledge. Don't do it under the carpet. This is what we are saying. shall neither falsify or interpret with their own or other qualifications, expressed what the Supreme Court told before, shall not maliciously do anything to tarnish directly or indirectly the reputation in respect of offices of others, shall not use the advantage of privileged position to compete unfairly with other engineers, shall exercise due restraint in explaining their own work and shall refrain from unfair criticism of work of other engineers. You go to a doctor, will a doctor describe, tell anything wrong with another doctor? They have very severe code of ethics. They may totally disagree with the other doctor's diagnosis, but he never said that he made a mistake. Right? You can talk about your work to impress on the management or someone that you have a solution, but you have no business to criticize anybody unless it's absolutely important that you really misbehave. Right? Clause 4 is engineers shall perform professional services only in the area of competence. Now this is very important. This is very important. I never do this. If I don't know anything, please think that you don't know. And get someone who knows about it, engage in the work. Shall undertake assignments only when qualified by education, I said that before, and experience in the specific technical fields involved. If an assignment requires qualifications and expertise outside their fields of competence, they shall engage competent professionals with necessary qualifications and experience and keep the employers and the clients informed of such arrangements. Shall not affix the signature to any designs or documents dealing with subject matter in which they lack competence, or to any plan or document not prepared under their direction and control. I have many stories to tell. I think I am running out of time. I met a person who gave a certificate about a line that was constructed. He has never been into this line. He has come to my project office, got some data, and when he went to the site, that day there was thick mist, and he could not even see from one place to another. And fortunately, this fellow made a blunder in drawing lines the way that he knew. And this went to the courts. And I had to give evidence against my own colleague because he made a blunder, not because I disliked him. So don't get caught doing things that you don't know. You can be taken to court for doing something wrong. Do something to know. And they shall apply their skills and knowledge in the interest of their employer or client for whom they shall act in professional manners for their pay as faithful agents or trustees, which means they trustees must be new, so far as they do not, there's a conflict with the other requirements listed here and the general public interest. Shall at all times avoid all known or potential conflicts of interest that involve the engineer himself. They should keep their employees or clients fully informed of all on all matters, including financial interest, which could lead to such a conflict. And under no circumstances should they participate in any decision which could involve them in conflict of interest. Shall in acting as administrators of a contract, most of we do that as clients, as engineers, be impartial between the parties in the interpretation of the contract. If you're acting as an engineer in a contract, I hope you know what an engineering contract is. It's independent. The requirement of impartiality shall not diminish the duty of engineers to apply their skill and knowledge in the interest of their employer or client. Shall not accept compensation, financial or otherwise, from more than one party for service on the same project. Unless the circumstances are fully disclosed in the agreement. If it is told that part of the money is coming from the consultant, part of the money is coming from the contractor, then you can do it. It's written. Shall neither solicit nor accept financial or other valuable consideration, including free engineering designs, etc., from material or equipment suppliers. Very often, when you are drawing tenders,
The suppliers come and give you a design. Sir, as a new design, you know, it's a breast, you know, they have seminars. And in the seminar, they drop, you know, the now nice designs. So take that into it and slowly those documents come into the tender book. You can't do that. Unless you yourself have verified or that you express that the design is from party ABC. Then that person becomes a nominated supplier of the design. You can do that. There are ways of doing it. Except some designs obtained with the knowledge and consent of the employer and the client. And it's known to everybody. Shall neither solicit nor accept gratuities directly or indirectly from contractors or their agents or other parties dealing with their clients or employers in connection with work for which they are responsible. Shall advise their clients or employers when as a result of their studies they believe that a project will not be viable. If we feel that the project will not be viable, then that as the option. Shall neither disclose nor use confidential information gained in the course of their employment without express permission, except where public interest and safety are involved. Shall not complete, sign or seal designs and specifications that are not safe to the public health and verify the conformity and in conformity with the accepted engineering standards. If the client or employee insists on such employment conduct, they shall notify the proper authorities and withdraw from further services of the day. You might lose a job. So what? If you lose a job, someone will hire you as a straightforward agent. I know that you can't do that. Very often, at least get another job in the same organization. Engineers shall give evidence, express opinions, or make statements in an objective and truthful manner. I'm not going into the details because time is running out. Engineers shall continue their professional development through their careers and shall actively assist and encourage engineers under their direction to advance their knowledge and experience. This we don't do. As senior engineers, once you become professional engineer, it's your duty to train your juniors. I know when this these kind of seminars were organized, the centers, I said, I'm worried about the turnover. Because sometimes I know the seniors tell them, no, what am I? Better they know. So they are prevented from going. I see a large number of people here. I'm sure your bosses have granted you leave to come and listen to the lecture. Go and thank your bosses. It's part of their duty they have performed. So when you become project engineers, you shall do so to your young engineers. Right? Allow them to further their careers. Allow them to further their knowledge. Send them for seminars, not every day. And send them for learned lectures, social lectures. I'll not go into details. Clause number 8 and the last one. Engineers shall be committed to the need for sustainable management of the patient, planet's resources and seek to minimize adverse environmental impacts of the engineering works or applications of technology so as to protect both present and future generations. The present and future generation comes from the word sustainable development. You have heard about that great Western chief's statement in handing over the lands of America to the Suddhas. This land does not belong to you and I. This land belongs to the future generations. Right? Once again, I'm not going to go into detail. I strongly suggest that you take at least good 2 hours reading this, understanding this, formulating in your own mind, how can I do this in my practice? Not only to answer the debate. How am I going to put this into practice in my own workplace? Where are the problems that I'm encountering? I must admit that we are not all saints. I must admit that I have made certain mistakes right throughout my life. Right? But honesty and integrity, I never compromise. Never in my life. Right? So maybe you have made wrong mistakes in this, any of these things. So correct yourself. And that's what we are trying to make. So go back. So I will go on to 3:30. Then we will have the break and I will have another chapter. Then go back to the Royal Academy of Engineering and the Engineering Council. Ethics and rigor, honesty and integrity, respect for law, life, law and public good, responsible leadership, listening and informing. Ethics and rigor. For engineers have a duty to ensure that they acquire the use and use wisely the and faithfully the knowledge that is relevant to the engineering skills needed in their work and in service to others. So they should always act with care and competence. Only comes with proper engineering education experience. Perform service only in the area of their current competence. One should not undertake work that is not within their area of competence. Fast forward all the code of ethics. Engineering Council. Keep their knowledge and skills up to date and assist the development of engineering knowledge and skills in others, what I just said. Continue to acquire new and updated knowledge and area of competence and love training of others. Look at the doctors. They always read many medical journals. If they don't, they kill patients. When you are small, we used to drink Disprin when you get few. No one takes Disprin now. Get a paracetamol or some other drug. Right? So they keep on improving their medical knowledge. Do we do that as engineers? No, we don't. So CPD courses are there for you to do that. Answering the B paper and becoming a professional is not the end of the road for engineers. You go on developing your professional skills. Follow CPD courses. Not knowingly mislead or allow others to mislead about engineering matters. Not speak of your opinions on matters or subjects areas not within one's area of competency as others may get misled thinking. As engineers, we should know what it all is. Like you want to give it? Are you in doubt? Are you not going to let them back? Yeah. Done that they are not done anything. Present and review engineering evidence, theory and interpretation, honesty, accurately and without bias. Identify and evaluate and where possible quantify risks. As engineers, we are supposed to assess risks and advise our clients about the risks that entail in any decision that we are supposed to take. As engineers, we seldom do this. We never tell what are the risks of doing something or not. Honesty and integrity. For engineers should adopt the highest standards of project conduct, openness, fairness and honesty. They should be alert to the ways in which their work might affect others and you respect the rights and reputation of the other parties. As an example, when we undertake infrastructure development projects, most of us are doing that, we must be aware of the other related work that will necessarily have to be undertaken and engage the relevant parties in the work. This is why I really promoted what we call the planning circles. I know that they are starting in Mathara. When you plan with the other engineers of the other sectors, maybe water, boat, telecom, roads, power, everybody, you share information. Right? Then you find solutions collectively. It's your duty to tell others that you are doing this work. Avoid deceptive acts. Take steps to create corrupt practices. Reject bribery or improper influence. Act for each employee or client in a reliable and trustworthy manner. Confidentiality placed in you by the employee should be upheld. For India should give respect for life, law and public good. For India should give way to all relevant laws, facts and published guidance and the wider public. They should ensure that all work is lawful and justified. You cannot break the rules and regulations. One has to respect the law of the land. Minimize and justify the adverse effects on society or the natural environment for their own and succeeding generations. Concepts of sustainable development. Take due account of the limited availability of natural and human resources. Hold paramount the health and safety of others. Act honorably, responsibly and lawfully and uphold the reputation, standing and dignity of the profession. Integrity is of paramount importance. Responsible leadership, listening and informing. For engineers should aspire to high standards of leadership in the exploitation and management of technology. They uphold a privileged and trusted position in society and expect to demonstrate that they are seeking to serve wider society and to be sensitive to public culture. They should therefore be aware of the issues that engineering and technology raises for society and listen to the aspirations of and concerns of others.
ఏ మనుష్యకి ప్రాబ్లమే మన తెలుగు కలపడం తీయడం
బంగారు మనుష్య ప్రాబ్లమ్ పబ్లిక్ కన్సల్టింగ్ ఇస్ నెసెసిటీ దట్ షుడ్ నాట్ బి నెగ్లెక్ట్ యాక్టివ్లీ ప్రమోట్ పబ్లిక్ అవేర్నెస్ అండ్ అండర్స్టాండింగ్ ఆఫ్ ది ఇంపాక్ట్ అండ్ బెనిఫిట్స్ ఆఫ్ ద ఇంజనీరింగ్ అచీవ్మెంట్స్ క్లియర్లీ అండ్ ఇన్ అ మేనర్ దట్ కెన్ బి ఈజీలీ అండర్స్టూడ్ ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ టు అదర్స్ వాట్ యు ఆర్ డూయింగ్ అండ్ ద కాస్ట్స్ అండ్ బెనిఫిట్స్ టు సొసైటీ ఇట్స్ సెల్డమ్ వి డూ దట్ యాజ్ ఇంజనీర్స్ We go and do the work, we don't care what the people think about our work. We object and truthful in a statement made in all interpreted commentary. All statements should be able to withstand any judgment and should be able to be verified for accuracy. I am sure. So we are going to take a break. Very heavy dose. I admit, started off with the debut of an engineer, impressed on her role in the society, went deep diving into the code of ethics, returned that to the international journal. All this we are giving. Not to pass the B paper and become a engineer, but to practice as an engineer thereafter, and even today, from today. So please take time, go through this, and study and get the whole thing into your body and let it run in your veins. So thank you very much. Any questions? I think we are going to have a small presentation, right? From Sethi. Are they ready? Sethi, I saw them running out. So when they run in, we can start the video. And two more presentations are coming later. Any questions? I can take. Are you ready with your?
Yes.
Now or later? After Lee or purely?
Three days.
David, you will have the video.
No. Presentation is ready. I am talking about the refreshment.
So we will have the presentation go over to you or not? Which way? What do you want to do? Have the presentation then go over to you?
We have preference. We have preference.
Balan, kutsa democratic thing. They are asking what you want. You want to go for tea or have the presentation? I said that we have the presentation because yes. We are going to have another heavy load after tea.
Okay.
The IPA does not mean that we become the legal institution in Sri Lanka for the stock market. But as you know from the 1960s, we have been trying to get our engineering council act passed, like the medical council. No doctor can practice here without the medical council institution. For whatever reason, unfortunately, in the engineering profession, we have not been successful. For about 70s we have been trying more vigorously. As the last 5-6 years, we are really there. The act is ready. Act has gone to the cabinet, cabinet has approved it, and is about to be placed in the parliament for approval. If it is placed in the parliament and approved, that's why all of us should be aware of this matter and educate all the local bodies that we know. Appe act ka pevelava. Support ekak denna right so any time anybody can put a spanner in the wheel that is what happened all this time so therefore we appeal to you that we get this engineering council act passed once the engineering council act is passed then only we can legally prevent any other non-engineer coming and practicing here just the other day my daughter is building a house next door I saw a quotation from an electrician The fellow has signed as design engineer. But that is the degree he has got from his company. Technician. Technician. He has signed the BOQ and the rates as design engineer. we have to do it now. Stop. Okay. We have one last question and then go to the. Yeah. Okay.
Question, sir. You have to explain many things.
Yeah.
But in practice, there are three major categories of engineers. One of government and consultants as well as contractors. So now, could you please explain me the?
Could you please explain me the how to behave, how to behave
in different roles?
This code of behavior that private in private sector according to that code of ethics, because this is not explained here.
Engineer, to me, an engineer is an engineer. There is the government service, corporate service, that is the para-government service, consulting engineers, contractors engineers, or wherever. If you agree to follow this, if you agree to get the ISO membership, you take the oath and say, I abide to follow the code of ethics. You raise your right hand. That's the way that you say that I will follow this code of ethics. And when you did the solemn promise, right? Like we take the solemn promise in the, when you take married to our spouse, I'm a Christian, we say, till death us do part, I'm married to you. I can't even divorce. But still I can have illegal connections with the other women. If my wife finds out, you know what happens. If someone puts a court case, you know what happens. Right? So we have to take the solemn promise that I shall follow this code of ethics. Be it he works for the most corrupt organization in this country. We know some of it, right? He can work for the most inefficient government sector organization in this country. He can work for the most efficient government sector organization in this country. Any para-government institution, any consulting institution, you agree to follow the code of ethics. If you do that, honestly and with due conscience, you will not go wrong, you will behave correctly everywhere. Finally, even your bosses who will think that you are stupid, will finally think that you are right. Right? This is my experience of 36 years. First, they may say, make a pissu. Moogie hill of Koma Hameka or Varad version of a. Finally, when these things start working, they will start honoring you, respecting you for what you said before. Right? I don't think there's anybody who has maybe done well. You have a lot of experience than I in this office, in this room. This is my experience. Not only working ZEEL, I've seen people in other organizations. I've been like this for the last so many years. I've gone length and breadth of this country. Right? I've spoken to a lot of people. Those who speak the truth and the right thing, they shine one day as brilliant. Others who, according to fraudulent practice or whatever may be, cut corners, do wrong designs, they will be seen to be glorifying for the moment, but their fall is very low. That's the only thing I get to do. Okay? We can have any more questions later on.
Okay, thank you, sir. Good afternoon to everyone. Actually, I'll be taking only a very few time just to tell you about the communication solutions provided by SLT. Mainly for the domestic users and SME, that means small and medium enterprise sector, right? I'll be taking around 5 minutes only. So first I'll be touching about the solutions provided to domestic users, that means these kind of services can be taken by you to your homes and very small boutiques like things, right? Those things actually you already might know. Anyway, I'll be explaining a little, so you'll get a better idea about the solutions of SLT. In fact, for the domestic users, we have three types of communication solutions, or in other words, three basic products. that is the voice solution, broadband solution and POTV solution. And if you take voice solutions, we have three main categories, that is wired and wireless. If you take a wired service, we have very old technology, which is around 150 years old in SL in Sri Lanka. That is the all-known copper wire technology. In other words, it is the PSTN, which means public switch telephone network. As engineers, you might know this term. And the newly introduced service or the technology is FTTH, fiber to the home. That is also actually SL is the only FTTH providing in Sri Lanka. So if you want to take a wired voice connection, you can go to either of these options, that is Mega Line or Smart Line. And if you want to take a wireless voice solution, that is also available with us, CityLink, the technology is CDMA, and 4G LTE, the technology is LTE. And if you want to get higher bandwidth internet connections, those are also available with us. One is coming along the Mega Line or the PSTN. The technology used there is asymmetric digital subscriber line. We are using second version of it, actually ADSL 2 Plus. And the other one is the broadband connection coming through fiber technology. And also, if you want to take wireless broadband, that is also available with LTE, which stands for long-term evolution. And we have another very popular service, that is the service, that is the television service we are providing. The brand name is POTV, Personal Entertainment Option Television, that you can get through, again, two technologies. One is the PSTN, other one is the FTTH. So if you compare these technologies, LTE, CDMA, PSTN, ADSL, and FTTH is the best technology, which provides very higher speeds. So if you take a POTV connection via FTTH technology, your POTV should be very clear, right? And in fact, the technology is capable of providing 1 Gbps, gigabits per second speed. And at the moment, SLT is providing 100 Mbps for domestic users. Actually, these are the services available to you to be used in your houses. And the other category is for the SME sector. For there also, actually, we have several solutions, not services, we call them solutions. Voice solution is there, managed services, networking, and data hosting. So there will be lot of things under these four categories, but I'll be not touching them because of the time. But I'll tell you a very few important things. Actually, these solutions which are provided by SLT are available with others also. For example, other service providers also providing these services. And if you take individuals, they are also providing these services. But if you subscribe to SLT service, the difference is that you are getting the service or the application and the connectivity, both, right? Other times you have to get the connectivity from SLT and applications from others. That is the difference. Okay, if you take, this is a very popular service, My Voice. It means that, for example, say that you are having a company of 50 employees, you can give those 50 employees or 50 voice connections, and you can make the calling free among that group, right? So it's a very simple solution, My Voice. And the other one, Remote Giver. This is actually a solution provided through CCTV cameras. So that's why I said to you earlier that the CCTV solution providers are everywhere in the town. But if you take it from us, SLT, you get both the application and the connectivity from us, right? At the cheaper rates, that is the most important thing. And VideoMe, So this is like some free VoIP services. We are having free service actually. If you take Skype also, this is available. We can do video conferencing with more than one person. So here also it is available in SLT, which you can go up to 50 participants, right? And the specialty in this video meet is you have a better controlling. You can have a moderator for the video conference. And since the application and connectivity are both from us, you will get excellent quality, right? And my way, simply it's we prepare websites for you, right? SLT prepares websites for you. That is our my way. And the business internet line, simply speaking, this is the internet connection, a high-speed internet connection provided to a company. The purpose of only browsing internet. So if it is a company, you might need a high bandwidth connectivity, right? If you take this business internet line, there will be no volume restrictions, right? So you can have unlimited internet if you subscribe to this service. And Value VPN, this is in fact the connection that we are giving to companies to interconnect their branches, right? It's a VPN, virtual private network connection, where you can have high speeds among your branches and head office. And this is another one, Web Self Care. It's like something like my portal. You can log into your account and do changes. You can add features and you can discontinue the features via the web. And this is actually not only to SME sectors. This is available to you, available to domestic users also. My webs, like my portal, right? So that's all. Simple thing. I just wanted to tell you about the common things that you might not know that SLT is providing, right? So thank you very much for giving the opportunity, sir. And it's a great pleasure to speak in front of engineers, as I am also an engineer, passed out from University of Rome. Thank you very much for giving the opportunity. Thank you.